Well, welcome to your own show, David. It's always fun to make you answer questions rather than ask them. So welcome to the podcast. How are you doing today?
I'm good, thanks. It's always better asking the questions than answering them. So I look forward to this with some trepidation.
Excellent. Well, it's always an absolute joy to dig into your predictions. Once again, you've gazed into your crystal ball and come up with some predictions for the year ahead, which we're going to spend some time exploring today. But for anyone that hasn't already read your article, many have on LinkedIn, please do go and check out David's predictions for 2022. They're excellent, and there's a great lively debate on there. You're free to add comments and add your own predictions as well, which is something we'll get into towards the end of this episode, actually. So first question for you, David, given that you do this every year, very bold of you to do so, very brave, how well did your predictions from last year do?
Well, you know, I thought you might ask that. So I did go back and mark last year's exam paper. The first thing to say, and let's get the excuses in now, is trying to predict the future is a mug's game. So that's a quote from Douglas Adams, who's the author of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, a fantastic book, it must be said, where I'm probably showing my age by mentioning it. But we all like to make the odd prediction. And for me, I find it's a really good way to reflect on the year that's gone, learn and plan for the year ahead. But to be fair, and in my defense, actually, many of last year's predictions were reasonably accurate. Now, maybe they were a bit safe, which could be the could be something that was could be levied at me. But, you know, take these three. So one, there's definitely been an increased focus on employee well-being. You know, certainly in the majority of firms we work with at Insight 222. And we've seen that consistently from the podcast guests we had throughout 2021. The one that really sticks out, I think, is the podcast episode with Arianna Huffington and Donna Morris, when Donna was talking about, you know, the efforts they're making around well-being at Walmart. Second, as I know we'll cover a bit later in our discussion, you'd expect me to say this, people analytics has grown as a function, and the emphasis really does seem to have shifted from a focus on influencing HR activities to one that's primarily focused on the impact in business outcomes. And I think the third area, and I know we're going to dig into this one as well, is the continued shift towards skills as a focal point. You know, the shift towards a skills-based organization is transforming the role and impact of HR. So definitely seeing that happening even more in 2021, thing even more in 2022. And if I could pick one of last year's predictions that hasn't really come to pass fully yet, I think I said, I better quote the words, HR becomes more digital, more agile, and more data literate. It's happening, but maybe not quite as quickly as I predicted or as I hoped. And for example, in the annual People Analytics Trends research we do at Insight 222, you know, although that's over across 100 global organizations, you know, although the CHRO in 90% of those organizations has pretty much mandated that people analytics is a core component of HR strategy, those same organizations reported that only 42% currently have a data-driven culture in HR. So plenty of work to do. So in summary, Ian, I might give myself a generous B or a B minus for last year's prediction.
Well, I think you're being very modest. I think that's really interesting. And I think we were just talking about it a little bit before starting the recording, which is, I think a lot of these, it's very hard to make these predictions because actually things do change quite slowly. And I think we'll dig into that a little bit. As you say, some of these trends are emerging, but a long way to go for some of them still. So, well, let's get into kind of what you were looking at for 2022. The first one that you went for, I do feel is a fairly safe prediction, a little bit of examining the year as well as looking forward, which is around hybrid working and the impact that the pandemic has had on all of us, our ability to actually go into an office and see others. But as you think about how this evolves, obviously, I don't expect you to predict how the pandemic is going to play out, because that does seem to be one that we can't all judge particularly well. But if we do get to this point where we have more choice around where we work, whether we go back to the office or not, what are your thoughts on how hybrid working will evolve in 2022 and beyond?
You're right, it's quite a safe prediction perhaps, but it's also probably one that's the biggest topic whenever we talk to, you know, our clients at Insight 222. And I did say last year would be the year that firms fully transitioned to hybrid ways of working, but that hasn't played out. And as you mentioned, that's largely due to the pandemic. The Delta and Omicron variants have delayed that wholesale return to office and postponed hybrid working in many cases. What's clear, though, and this is where the prediction really comes in, is there's a growing chasm between employers who yearn for a return to significant in-person working and employees who don't, or, you know, at least according to the many numerous surveys that we see. So when you then factor in the great resignation, and we can debate how real that is or not, but when you cut through the hype of that, it appears to be primarily about the pandemic causing employees to reflect on what they want from their lives. You know, it becomes a bit more interesting, and maybe that isn't, you know, the long commute to work 3 or 4 days a week, you know, and long hours, and maybe people don't want that anymore. So I think we've arrived at a bit of an inflection point about where, when and how work gets done, and employees arguably have the upper hand in what seems to be quite a buoyant marketplace. So the prediction really is about HR orchestrating that shift to hybrid and brokering that deal between leaders and workers, and hopefully, we're seeing, using people data to inform that transition, you know, and that comes into something we're going to talk about later. Having that effective approach to continuous employee listening can certainly help shape that path, you know, and it really helps shape the context around future ways of working, not just for leaders, so that their policies can gain support from the workforce. But, you know, I don't know if you saw, but Microsoft, you know, talked about that hybrid paradox where people are saying they want the flexibility of working from anywhere, but they also crave more in-person connection. So there is a balance that as the pandemic plays out, we might see move one way and the other, depending on where we are from a health perspective. But I mean, the reason I put it number one is the prize is it could be significant, you know, for companies and HR functions that do it well. You know, if you get the approach to hybrid right, you know, and that's not just the where, which we seem very fixated on at the moment, but the when and the how, getting that approach right so it attracts rather than repels, you know, top talent, that could turn, you know, for individual organizations, the threat of the great resignation in actually being able to attract people into their organization. So, really, you know, we've heard from companies like Salesforce and IBM and Microsoft and others on the podcast, I think, that are thinking like that and putting employees at the center of their approach to hybrid working. And there are other organizations that aren't, you know, and it'll be interesting to see how that plays out in the next 12 months. But the biggest wish, of course, is that the pandemic starts to recede.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think what we've also seen kind of anecdotally, I haven't actually seen a lot of data on this yet, but I think it would be interesting to see is just the ability to attract talent now from wherever, you know, particularly somewhere like the US, where maybe someone needed to move from East Coast to West Coast or something like that, actually to now hire people wherever they are, as long as they're within a similar-ish time zone, or maybe in some cases, even if they're not. And I think that's kind of opening up opportunities for employees, but also for employers to find different talent to fit those jobs. So yeah, it'd be fascinating to see how that one plays out. And I guess whilst kind of thinking about data, one of your favorite topics, again, it's not a big surprise to see people analytics in as one of your predictions and for that to evolve further. It's definitely been a phenomenal year for the field, and we've seen a lot of progression and a lot of different ways that people analytics has really been used more, and we've seen that field evolve. When you look now into 2022, kind of what do you think's next for people analytics? You know, what about themes like trust and ethics that you mentioned in your predictions? How do you see all of this playing out in the coming year?
Well, I'll come back to the trust and ethics bit secondly, but don't remind me if I forget as well. I thought it might be helpful for listeners actually to start, you know, with the first part of the question and maybe highlight some of the findings that we found in our People Analytics Trends report. So that was published towards the end of last year in October. You know, and as I mentioned earlier, it's informed by a survey of more than 114 global companies. You know, it really, as you said, it really highlighted that growth in the field and really builds on what Jonathan and I wrote in Excellence in People Analytics. You know, the growth of people analytics, the investment in people analytics by leading organizations, and the impact of people analytics are all rising exponentially. Long may that continue. You know, in just 12 months, actually, from doing the survey in 2020, we saw that the ratio of people analytics professionals to overall FTE in the companies we surveyed improved to one people analytics professional to every 2,900 employees from 1 to 4,000, which is quite a significant increase. And 75% of those companies told me that those functions are going to grow even more in the next 18 months. In fact, only one of those 114 companies said that their people analytics team would shrink, and they were just about to divest a third of their organization. So, you know, people analytics is growing in pretty well, certainly in the organizations that we surveyed, which, you know, quite a representative sample. You know, also we found that CHROs are more or less unanimous now that people analytics is important. The 90% figure I mentioned earlier, that's saying it's a clear part of HR strategy. And we also found that the 89% of people analytics either report directly now to the chief people officer or a member of the HR leadership team. So that was 75% 12 months previously. So again, everything's tracking upwards in that respect. You know, and we know because we hear the stories, you know, in our privileged position at Insight 222, and we saw in a lot of the case studies that Jonathan and I collected in the book, 30 of them, that, you know, when it's impactful, people analytics is contributing millions of dollars of value to the top and bottom lines. You know, and if you can create that data-driven culture in HR, you can really scale and enhance that value even further. So if that, what does that mean about 2022? So if we look at the clues as to what to expect, you know, maybe we should look at some of what the leading companies are doing. You know, this is a question that Jonathan and I were attempting to answer in the book, because it's a question we get asked a lot. And it's an area that we really looked at in the research as well. And it's basically, perhaps not surprisingly, the leading companies invest more in people analytics, you know, bigger teams, more in technology. They productize analytics at scale, which I think is key. And we're going to be talking about, you know, personalized learning, personalized talent mobility, and everything else. You know, getting data into the hands of HR business partners, but also managers in the business, so they can make more informed decisions. We're really seeing that in the leading organizations. And they've created that data-driven culture for HR as well. You know, and I know we're gonna talk about that as well. So really lots of activity happening, and you know, those leading companies are kind of pointing the way a little bit. You know, we're fortunate we've had a number of people from those companies on the podcast. Patrick from ABN AMRO, Ernest Ding from Salesforce, just to mention two we've had recently, Jeremy Shapiro from Merck & Co., Alexis Soussignon from Merck KGaA. You know, and maybe one of the areas that we're seeing even more focus is the ethics question, as you mentioned. So I didn't forget it, which is good. You know, and let's be honest, with people analytics, employee trust is hard to earn and easy to lose. So it's got to be at the forefront of you know, company strategies around people analytics. Creating trust is key to creating that sustainable success. You'll remember, Ian, because you led this piece of work, that when we created the ethics charter all the way back in 2018 at Insight 222, you know, and with the client, some of the clients at the time, that was partly catalyzed by the EU's introducing the GDPR regulations in 2018. There's a lot more regulation on the horizon. The EU's now looking at regulating the use of AI by companies, not just with customers, but within the organization. The EEOC in the US is also looking at the context of AI in the workplace, and particularly around hiring algorithms. And New York has actually just introduced legislation related to the use of hiring algorithms. So this is an ongoing case of legislating. Now, that's not the only reason why companies should be paying attention to ethics as well. You know, delivering benefits to employees through people analytics isn't just the right thing to do. It actually has a positive impact on business performance. You know, one of my favorite pieces of research is a study Accenture did a couple of years ago. I think it might have been back in 2019, where they were looking at, you know, what's the potential value of workforce data that organizations already had in their systems. And they found that where companies took a responsible approach and put trust at the forefront of people data, the trust dividend, as they called it, could be worth more than a 6% increase in future revenue growth, which, if you think about the amount of revenue some big organizations are making, is absolutely huge. In a couple of quick examples, I mean, one of the 30 case studies in excellence and people analytics comes from Lloyds Banking Group and outlines how they developed an ethics charter that protects employees and drives value for the company. And then on the podcast, perhaps one of the best examples that we had on the podcast was from Jimmy Zhang, who at the time was leading people analytics at Vertex Pharmaceuticals. He says one of the first priorities of setting up people analytics was to create that ethics charter with those guiding principles that they were shared that with employees, and it helped drive that trust and transparency around people analytics in the company. And if you think about some of the things that Jimmy was telling us that they were doing at Vertex, you know, building their own talent marketplace, using sensing data to help the organization see around corners in terms of looking at what competitors are hiring, you can see by putting that ethics element right at the core of what they're doing was so important. So yeah, I think we'll hear more talk about ethics and trust in people analytics next year. And obviously, of course, one of the reasons for that is there's more data available for organizations to analyze in people analytics, and some of that data is arguably more sensitive than the data we've got in our HR systems.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess what we're seeing more and more as well, and we've heard this a lot in the last year on the podcast, is that link to the business becoming stronger and stronger, incorporating more than just HR data into people analytics work as well. And so do you see that it is the business that is driving that shift and a kind of demand for more information? Or do you see that it's kind of HR really trying to push that information out, or a bit of both?
I think it's a bit of both. I think if you look at the challenges that people analytics teams, or certainly the more developed people analytics team, are studying, like hybrid working, like collaboration, like burnout, like well-being, like inclusion. You know, these are, you know, you need decent data for that, and you need data that's not just HR data, you know, typical HR data to look at that. And particularly, I know we're going to talk about a little bit later when we talk about listening, but you know, some of that collaboration data, you know, calendar, email, metadata, maybe data coming from Slack and Teams and Zoom and all the other technologies that we're using to collaborate with each other virtually, yeah, everything's trackable now. Oh. Think about it. You know, if we're all working from home, pretty much the way we communicate with each other now is you know, you can track that, and you can get some great insight from it as well. You know, you can get insight that really help employees. You can identify burnout risk. You can identify, I know, manager behaviors that actually, you know, the importance of managers checking in and doing one-to-ones with people, which, you know, Microsoft found is even more important in hybrid work. You know, onboarding new people. We've onboarded new people at Insight 222, and we've had to do that fully remotely. It's very different from how we would have done it in the past. So yeah, I think it's been driven by the business, but I also think that, you know, as people analytics teams become more sophisticated, as HR does become more digital and data driven, I think HR professionals themselves are seeing the possibilities of some of these technologies, and they want to use that, you know, to help the business and to help the workforce.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And I guess one of the areas that we've really seen grow in that respect as well, particularly due to the pandemic, is the rise of the talent marketplace technology. We've seen learning experience platforms, LXPs, really growing in the last few years as well. And then that was kind of sped up quite a lot by the pandemic as well for some companies. And all of this starts to allow us to focus a bit more on skills, which is, again, a topic that's been talked about for a few years now, but has been quite hard to get a grip on. And so as we kind of move beyond the kind of legacy of competency frameworks and move more to understanding skills of the workforce, how do you see that playing out in 2022? You know, and can you give any examples you think of companies that are really doing this well and are at the forefront?
Well, I know I'm preaching to the converted a little bit here, talking to you, Ian, because I know you actually started doing this at Cisco years ago, you know, back in what, 2015, 2016, you were looking at. You know, but the increasing shift to a focus on skills is you know, arguably leading to a pretty radical transformation of HR. You know, and arguably we're only at the early stage of this transformation. So, you know, I know from the research that you did for the workforce planning playbook, which I'll probably ask you about in a minute, turn it back to you. 90% of companies told us they want to build skills-based workforce planning, but only a quarter were currently doing so. So that shows that there's a lot of room to grow there. So one organization that's obviously doing this well, we had Anshul Shiapuri of IBM on the podcast recently, and he talks about skills acting as a silver thread that connects all aspects of the employee journey. And we've talked before, Ian, I think we talked on this episode last year about how, you know, this focus on skills is breaking down some of those traditional silos in HR. And basically what IBM had done is through natural language processing and machine learning, they've been able to infer the skills of all employees within the organization, which is, you know, over 300,000 people, much better than asking people for their skills. And actually, apparently, you know, from what Anshul was telling us and what Diane Gerson told us last year, it's actually more accurate as well. And then IBM has developed technology that provides these employees with recommendations on learning, on career paths, on mobility, mentors, you know, and it's linked all that together. So, which makes sense, doesn't it? We think we've already operated in these silos a little bit before. And it's even enabled them to shift, so Anshul told us, from pay for performance to pay for skills. So that kind of gives you an indication of where this could go. You know, so that's an example of a company that's built technology focused on skills, you know, and Salesforce and Vertex have done something similar in that respect. And I understand Spotify have just announced that they've built their own talent marketplace as well. You know, others have chosen to partner with companies like Gloat, Degreed, Eightfold, Fuel 50. There are others as well, you know, who collectively are behind what, you know, arguably is one of the hottest technology innovations in recent years, the talent marketplace. You know, we've had HR leaders from Schneider Electric, IQVIA, Standard Chartered, who have all implemented talent marketplace. But I think, you know, certainly from in terms of what they actually publish publicly, I think it's probably Unilever that's probably the best example here. You know, I remember the podcast discussion we had with Jeroen Wells, you know, back in March 2021, I think it was, where he explained that they'd used Talent Marketplace and used it for about 3 years, I think, to create a culture of internal mobility at the company. You know, one powerful example that Jeroen gave was how their Talent Marketplace had enabled the Unilever to redeploy over 3,000 people from parts of the business with low demand to areas that were experiencing really high demand due to the pandemic. And I know Jeroen said one of his proudest moments was that it had such an impact that Unilever's CEO, Alan Jope, mentioned it in one of their quarterly earnings calls, you know. So, but Ian, I'd love to turn it back to you for comment, because I know this is an area I do bow to your extra expertise than mine on this. You know, how do you see the focus on skills playing out in 2022? And are there any other examples that you can think of that you'd like to add to the mix?
Yeah, so I'm not going to let you off the hook too much. You know, I'm going to answer this one quickly and then get back to grilling you. But as you mentioned, we did do a big piece of research around workforce planning. And one of the biggest kind of central themes really was this shift to a skill-based workforce planning model. And I think exactly as you said, and as we talked about last time, and we've heard others talking about, I think what is really fascinating about the skills conversation is that it is breaking down silos and that it is touching many different parts of HR, or indeed bringing together many different parts of HR. And really, if you start to think about it through the eyes of the employee, which obviously more and more companies are doing with a more human-centered design approach, you realize that, you know, employees don't want to think about learning over here and recruitment over there. And, you know, Diane talked about that as well. It really is about understanding your job, your career, you know, where you're going to go next, you know, what you can learn. Performance management can even creep in there as well. You know, there's many different factors. And so I like what Anshul said around skills really being the thread. And so something that we saw in the research was that people will come at it from many different angles. And so very few people are actually saying, oh, I'm going to tackle workforce planning and make it skill-based. Actually, the entry point in is often, oh, we're going to introduce this learning system that allows us to start to build that skill taxonomy, or we're going to go with talent marketplace because we're keen on assignments or internal mobility, or, you know, or some other focus. And that it could be recruitment, for example, and that allows them to then start to build this muscle of skills. But it is a really big topic. It's a really big nut to crack. And I think what's happened over the last few years, which I think is really helping the rise, is that technology has got a lot better. Mm-hmm. And so to think of that IBM example where they're inferring skills rather than asking people to fill out forms or whatever it might be, then actually, as we see machine learning becoming more capable, we see this technology advancing, it becomes something that you can start to understand more about what people are doing, the work they're doing, the skills they have, without having to ask them. And I think for me, that's the bit that's going to be really interesting, is really all we're trying to do with all of this is get a better understanding of work. Like, what is what we need from people, whether it's a job, a task, whatever it might be? How do we understand that in its various parts? How do we define that? It's not just actually about skills. It's about knowledge. It's about experience. It's about all of these things. And we're just scratching the surface of being able to really understand them. I mean, that's why competencies and competency frameworks have been so popular, because they are kind of, they try to be more than skills. But by doing that, they almost become intangible. And so as we start to double down on skills, how will we start to understand all these other aspects as well? And I think ultimately get a better understanding of the work that we need people to do, and then understand what people can do and what they are doing. And that at its very simplest, you know, form is what we're trying to do. And it's great to see that starting to play a role in workforce planning. The last thing I'll say is that with all of that, what we're also seeing in the workforce planning space is a shift to be more continuous. This is less about an annual plan that ends up in a drawer, you know, 3 to 5 year timeframes. We, of course, need to be looking further out. But the reality is that people are really focusing on the next 6, 12, 18 months a lot of the time, and they really want to be able to plan for that organization. And so being able to do this on a more continuous basis ultimately requires data. And that's where all of this starts to pull together. So yeah, I'm really excited to see how this plays out. And I think it, you know, it is technology and analytics that ultimately is going to pave the way here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're doing this episode next year, yeah, and I'm
No chance. So let's shift gears and allow you to keep talking. I wanted to talk a little bit about employee listening and employee voice. Again, it's a topic we've spoken to a lot of leaders about. You know, heard a lot of people on the podcast talking about it. This last year in particular, you mentioned at the beginning the shift to a focus more on employee well-being. Obviously, the pandemic has just brought that front and center. How do you think this is going to play out? You know, if the pandemic starts to kind of wane and we start to get back to a more normal life, then do you see that companies are going to keep going with this? You know, have we really kind of made a change that's going to be here for the future? And what else do you think people might start doing in this area?
Yeah, I mean, I think if there is a positive consequence of the pandemic in the workplace, is that leaders seem more, you know, to be genuinely interested in seeking feedback from their employees and paying more attention to well-being. So that's good. Do I think it will stay? Yes, because I think once the genie's out of the bottle, it's going to be very hard to put it back in. And actually, there's business benefits of doing so. And there's been plenty of research. Ethan Burris, I think, from can't remember which university it was in. It's in Texas, though. You know, and he did some research and showed that, you know, when companies let, you know, give that forum or that forum for employees to be able to speak up, you know, the company benefits. And it's pretty obvious, I suppose, in some respects, isn't it? If you've got employees on the front line working with customers and you're making it easy for them to give feedback and make suggestions, then why wouldn't that be helpful? So you could also make a strong case that, you know, we are in the midst of the pandemic. So, you know, and I think we will be for the foreseeable future, you know, and all that focus on the great resignations, that companies will step up their employee listening programs even further next year. You know, and as you said, there's been some powerful stories throughout the last 2 years. You know, the examples that really resonate with me, and perhaps this gives a clue as to where employee listening and continuous listening may go, are those that are combining survey data from either doing far more regular surveys, pulse surveys, you know, even to the extent that some companies like Microsoft are doing it daily, you know, but combining that with some of the collaboration data that we talked about earlier to gain to gain insights around topics like well-being, collaboration, innovation, risk, burnout risk. You know, that is a great example of Uber, you know, where the analysis of survey responses and data from some of the collaboration tools that they use, it highlighted the pressure on focus time due to remote working. And then, you know, and that basically, you know, it was having an impact on employees, self-reported saying they didn't feel as productive, longer working hours, burnout risk. So they then actually tried to address that partly through education by actually helping employees understand the importance of focus time, but then enablement, actually creating a tool that actually rearranged people's calendars for them. You know, and that helped, you know, the employees cope with some of the collaborative overload that they were dealing with. You'll remember that we had Microsoft Chief People Officer Kathleen Hogan as a guest on last summer. You know, and she explained how that daily pulse that I just mentioned of 2,500 employees, coupled with analysis of that collaboration data, has really helped shape Microsoft's approach to hybrid work. You know, and you know, and certainly, you know, we've seen lots of stuff from Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella talking about the future of work and that we won't be going back to what it was prior to the pandemic, which is different from other CEOs that I could mention. And then just before Christmas, Microsoft People Analytics leader Dawn Klinghoffer, you know, she had a really fascinating article in Harvard Business Review, which I really recommend anyone listening to check out. You know, during 2020, Microsoft saw a 13% fall in employee satisfaction with work-life balance. So the People Analytics team, you know, really dug into some of the collaboration data, the survey data over several months. They identified there were three triggers of that. Over collaboration, so similar to Uber, lack of focus time, similar to Uber, and not taking vacation. So they rolled out four strategies, but I think what's really good about these four strategies, they didn't just communicate this to employees, they actually made managers accountable for it to make sure that the change that they were trying to effect was systemic. So that was around managers helping their teams prioritize work, you know, and accepting, you know, if I'm going to do this, what do you want me to drop? Because we can't do everything, which is quite a grown-up conversation to have in an organization. You know, reevaluating meetings, protecting focus time, and encouraging vacation. And I think we can all probably think about how beneficial vacation has been, even if you're not leaving the house in the last 2 years. It's just getting the break from the screen and the grind of email and everything else. And I think that example does show. Provide a clue as to where employee listening could go, I think, in this year in 2022 and beyond. You know, that passive data increasingly being incorporated into continuous listening. And if it's focused on benefiting employees, as it has in the examples that I've mentioned, it's going to be much easier to gain support from privacy, info security, works councils and employees themselves. And I think that's the challenge for people analytics teams to do, make sure the work is directed around there. You know, and the potential is enormous. You know, not only can it help companies maybe turn the supposed great resignation the other way around, but it can help with things like inclusion and well-being and collaboration. And frankly, as I said at the outset, business outcomes, better customer outcomes, product development, all those sorts of things. You know, so I do think, as I said, that employee listening is going to be a huge focus going forward, and it's no coincidence that the co-creation we're doing this year with clients of the People Analytics Program is employee listening, because we're getting so many questions about it and so much interest. I don't know what your thoughts are around employee listening, Ian, because I know it's a topic we're all passionate about inside 222.
Yeah, no, I think the fact that things are changing so much at the moment on such a, you know, constant basis, and the need to therefore listen more to employees I think you could argue the need has always been there, but I think companies have recognized that need and have moved accordingly. I mean, you mentioned kind of inclusion. We've obviously seen, you know, a massive focus from organizations around diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging, all of these topics really surfacing in the last year as well. How do you think that's evolving? You know, what do you think companies will be doing differently to keep tackling that?
I think it's almost like companies are moving now beyond rhetoric to action. And I think people analytics is playing a huge role in enabling that shift, which is, you know, about time, frankly. You know, again, let me refer back to our people analytics trend research. You know, perhaps the finding that brought the warmest glow, I think, to several of us was that when we asked those companies for the top three areas where people analytics is adding value, it was diversity, equity, inclusion that emerged as the top area, you know, with 54% of companies placing it in the top three. I think it was 22% last year, if I remember my numbers. So that's a massive increase. You know, and I think, you know, the evidence of the business value of diversity and inclusion, you know, continues to mount up. You factor in employee expectations, the catalyst provided by the social injustice movement in 2020, and the capability that people analytics provides from to help companies go from just counting numbers to understanding inclusion, doing lots of work around pay equity and belonging, then maybe it's not a surprise that there's more focus and success in this area. And it maybe brings, you know, back to the what potentially could be the broader societal benefit that people analytics and HR can bring. You know, so, and as a diversity, equity, inclusion, you know, you could add hybrid work and mental health to that, are complex topics. They're increasingly important to CEOs, you know, and chief people officers, and they require a deep understanding of the workforce and evidence, which is why people analytics is so critical, and perhaps one of the reasons why people analytics is growing so much. So yeah, I would expect that to continue again in 2022.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think one thing that we've also really seen evolve this year is just the ability for people to have a voice on those issues more, and companies to be listening. And I think what we're seeing as part of that, I guess, is a change again in the way that people are thinking about their employees and what employees want from work and from the experience of work. And if we think about that and how HR technology is kind of playing into that, we've already talked a little bit about this, but you know, we've seen the HR technology market really, you know, increase in terms of value and adoption in the last few years. Now seeing quite a few unicorns, actually starting to see, not surprisingly, quite a few mergers and acquisitions happening this year as well. What's your prediction for how we'll see the HR technology market to continue to grow? And, you know, is it around this theme of employee experience that, you know, we'll see driving that, or do you think there's other things that will impact that?
It's interesting. One thing I should have said around diversity and inclusion, actually related to technology and analytics, is, you know, looking at some of the collaboration data, you can start to understand inclusion in teams. You can start to understand inclusion of new hires and stuff like that. And I think that's an important driver, one of the drivers that's certainly growing HR technology. But yeah, I mean, 2021, wow, what a phenomenal year, including to, according to one report I saw, I think it was but from Jason Corsella at Acadian, VC investment was set to top 15 billion, I think, 2021, which is 300% increase apparently on the year before. So I think it's pretty safe to say there'll be more investment next year. I don't know, that's probably quite a safe one. You know, we saw some consolidation in 2021. You know, Peakon was acquired by Workday, MZ and Burning Glass, two companies I know you know well, merged. So I think we'll see more consolidation in 2022. It seems like there's a lot of very successful small to medium technology companies now. They're getting a lot of traction. They got quite a lot of investment in 2021. So, you know, the big boys and big girls will be around looking to snap them up. You know, I think the areas to watch, I think anything skills related. So that external labor market data, marketplace, the talent marketplace, technologies that actually help skills inference and maybe help companies then use that data and recoup some of the investment they've made in some of the other technologies that they've bought over the previous years. Think employee listening. You know, I think we saw a lot last year. Obviously, I mentioned Peakon, SAP part spun out Qualtrics. We've seen other movements in that area. Obviously, LinkedIn bought Glint a few years ago. These companies are being very successful. CultureAmp got more investment. Perceptive's got more investment. Medallia has emerged as a technology in that space. So I think we'll see them increasingly incorporating passive data into their offering, whether that's through acquisition or whether that's through product. I guess we'll wait to see. That organizational network analysis space has threatened to take off for years, so maybe 2022 will be the year that finally happens. But Ian, I am going to turn this one back to you, because again, you've studied the HR tech market for a long time, initially as a buyer, then you actually analyze the market for a while, and obviously part of what you're doing at Insight22, the many things you're doing at Insight22 is making sure you understand that market well. So I'd love to hear what you think.
Yeah, I mean, I obviously agree with everything you've said. I think the only thing I would add really is, I think what we've seen from the increase in different types of HR technology, particularly some of the newer point solutions that people are plugging in, is we now have even more data than we've ever had before. You know, you could argue the problem a few years back, you know, particularly when I was spending more time on this, was that we just didn't have a lot of data on people. We were really just reliant on those core HR systems, and they didn't really have much of any interest, you know, to do a lot with. Now it's completely different. There's an abundance of data that we're generating all the time. All of these new tools and technologies are enabling companies to kind of build those data sets. I would say what is kind of next is, how do we use that data, understand that data, but ultimately use that data to make people's lives better? You know, it is the kind of what's in it for me type side of things. And I think this, and what I'm not talking about is what can the people analytics team do with the data, which I know they're starting to spend more time on. It's really, how do these tools start to build actual usability and functionality into their platforms that mean that you're not looking at reports about how many meetings you're in, but actually there's something happening as a result, you know, more on the recommendation side. And, you know, we hear people all the time say, should be like Netflix, should be like Spotify. And I think it has become a bit of a trite statement, I guess. But the reality is, when you think about a lot of the technologies you do use, the amount of data that they are looking at and then using that behind the scenes to then do something, and we could argue sometimes they even get it wrong, is quite phenomenal. And I just don't think we're at that stage at work yet. You know, really, it is still very rudimentary in terms of the types of analysis and insights that we're getting back as users of these technologies. And so for me, I think that's the area that I'm kind of most excited about now, and how that's going to play out.
Yeah, I think you're right. And, you know, and actually, how better to, you know, benefiting the people who actually provide the data, you know, employees.
Yeah, absolutely.
Making it usable for them to actually do something about it.
And make it better for their experience at work, to find a job, to find training, to do whatever, right? Manage their careers and just ultimately have a better experience at work. Yeah. Okay, so you always give me a bit of a hard time on the podcast, David, about how I'm going to cut you off and we're not keeping whether you're keeping the episode to time or not. So I'm going to play that role now, particularly as I'm actually getting to interview, and say that we're nearing the end of time. And so we've just got a couple more questions to get into today. One is really around the need for HR to upskill, be more data-driven, be more digital. Obviously, this is something we've talked about a lot. You know that I spend a lot of time doing this, working on this for Insight22. But I think we are seeing a shift here. You know, you've cited some of the information from the survey around actually the appetite now for CHROs for HR to change. And we are seeing more of a push coming from a lot of different organizations. What are you seeing from your conversations with HR leaders around this? And what's your prediction for how it might evolve?
Yeah, I think for all the reasons that we've talked about, you know, the increased thirst from the C-suite during the pandemic for people, data and insights, you know, more focus on inclusion and well-being, you know, understanding what hybrid work's going to be, you know, in each company, you know, the desire for HR to be data-driven now is is high, you know, and there is that delta between what the CHRO is mandating versus the reality at the moment. And I suppose the prediction is that, you know, we'll start to close that gap, hopefully quite significantly in 2022. You know, from this research and conversations we have with leaders on the podcast and actually the research, we identified three interlocking elements that kind of all need to be managed together to drive that data-driven culture. You know, number one, you need to invest in your people analytics function. You know, that's people, that's skills, that's technology, but it's also the productization we talked about earlier to scale and put stuff in the hands of managers and employees, as you just said. You know, to embed data decision making across manager, HR and managers. Well, how do you do that? You know, yes, we can support, we can upskill HR professionals. That's an important part of it, but you can't do that on its own. And yes, that's not training people to be analysts necessarily. That's helping them be more data literate, help them improve their consulting and influencing and storytelling skills. But it's also by democratizing data across the company. You know, but you're investing in technologies that are accessible, easy to use, user-friendly, as we've talked about, you know, and support, it's a change, you know, so we've got to invest in supporting that change management process in HR, clear communications from the CHRO, you know, it's celebrating success. I mean, again, referring, because maybe it was one of the more recent episodes, Anshul Shiapuri at IBM saying, you know, celebrate HR professionals that embody a data-driven culture, you know, at meetings that the CHRO is hosting or at all hands, you know, show the way that it's incentivizing that career journey for HR professionals, that this is something that's going to help them, not just in their careers, but in their day-to-day work as well. So I think that's really important. And then if we can start to be better at demonstrating the business value. So that was the third thing we found, you know, calculating the ROI, you know, from a people analytics perspective, that I guess means working with finance at the outset of a piece of work and agreeing how you're going to measure value, you know, really interacting with the stakeholders in the business, not just stakeholders in HR, you know, and doing it together with HR business partners, and then communicating the value of data-driven HR across the company. So Microsoft have a hashtag data-driven HR, which they do to communicate any story about people analytics. That's really nice and simple. We've had others on the show. You know, again, I go back to Alexis Susinon at Merck, really talking about how they do that. You know, they set the expectation, they provide the tools, they develop communities of practice, and recognize it's a journey. You know, it's not something you can just give someone a training course and a week later they're a data-driven HR professional. But it's not just data, is it? I mean, that's the thing. And obviously,
no, it's not. And I think that point you just made there around, you know, yes, training is going to play a role here. There is a lot of capability building that needs to happen, new skills. And data is one that is pretty new for HR. You know, not many people got into HR because they like dealing with data, right? And so to your point, that it's not going to happen overnight. You know, this is a multi-year journey for HR. But I think there's a lot of other areas, you know, to throw into that mix. You know, understanding the impact of digital, you know, really getting into that employee experience piece is really still so new. Mm. And, you know, taking a more user-centric design approach to everything that we do in HR. And then I think it is the communication of all of this back to the business as well. You've talked a little bit about it, but, you know, the stakeholder management, really understanding the business and really being able to tell a story about what's going on and make sure that that drives action ultimately that adds value to the business. And so I think those are some of the areas that we're seeing all kind of come together. I'm sure more are going to get added over time, of course, as well. And the fact that HR is now focusing a bit more on itself, I think is great as well. Mm. And not just focusing on the skills of the organization. But I do think it's a multi-year journey. It's a big shift for the function. And we're only just getting started, but it does feel like the appetite is now really bubbling up and people are seeing more of a need for it, which I think is great. Okay, so last question to kind of bring us home on this. when you posted your predictions out on LinkedIn, we've seen, as I said, a massive number of comments and discussion going on, which is always great to see. But you actually invited others to add their own predictions, of which you've seen many too. When you kind of looked through all of that and with everything else that we've been discussing today, you know, is there anything else you'd like to kind of add around what you're going to see evolve as for the role of HR in organizations in the future, and particularly highlight any of the things that the community have added as well?
Yep. The first thing to say is a huge thank you to everyone that's taken the time to contribute a suggestion. There are numerous on there. I never would have thought there would be as many as they have. And, you know, and most of the ideas are actually really, really good as well. And actually, frankly, much better than my predictions. So it's going to be quite hard to choose the two that I add to the list. So which makes me think maybe I should crowdsource everything next year. I think what they do, and I think what we've talked about as well, is it, you know, HR has been on a long journey from a function that was focused on compliance, process, standardization, and intuition to one that's now, or certainly going to be in some cases, but is already in others, focused instead on skills, products, personalization, and data. That's the, as you've said, that's not a, you know, this week we're a compliance-based function, next week we're a product-based function. That is a long journey. Now, I think that's accelerated since the start of the pandemic. You know, the pandemic has elevated the role of the HR function. And we can see that from all the work that we do. We can see that from a lot of the suggestions and comments on the article. You know, particularly where those functions are well led, they're already data driven. They've got, you know, good people analytics teams. They invest in those people analytics teams. They're focused on creating personalized experience, you know, and they're focused as well, actually, on having an impact on business outcomes. You know, which I think is maybe the big leap that HR generally still has to make. You know, and that it actually extends to probably broader societal areas that we talked about, like inclusion, but also climate and sustainability. So that was one of the, that's certainly a suggestion a few have made. HR's got a real big role to play here, not just to help the organization achieve its goals, but actually to make sure the organization is listening to employees who increasingly are quite, you know, they're quite active about this, and they want to work for companies that are actually good for the climate and actually care about it. And actually that kind of leads to a couple of suggestions I've pulled out. And these are ones that I can remember off the top of my head. So again, Diane Gerson, former IBM Chief Human Resources Officer. So her suggestion was related to that. You know, how will HR cope with this increased employee activism? You know, particularly in the US, where this, you know, where this is happening, where maybe they don't have those works councils and the employee representative groups in place. So she highlighted this as a challenge for HR, and I think it is, but it's one that HR should embrace, because it could almost help be the collective voice of the employee then on these topics. And then our friend Dave Orich, I have to mention Dave because he's been on the podcast, I think, more times than any guest, actually. He suggested that, you know, the HR needs to shift from an increased focus on outcomes rather than activities. And I think a lot of what we've talked about over the last sort of 50 minutes or so in does actually play to that. But I think there's still quite a long way to go. And, you know, and actually it's what's quite interesting. I don't know if you look at the Edelman Trust Barometer, which is quite well respected, you know, in business. Last year, for the first time, they came that employees are now the most important stakeholder to a business's success. More important than customers, more important than shareholders. And I think it's not hard to see that this creates a huge opportunity for HR, and maybe also shows why HR is arguably the most exciting place to work in business at the moment. So, you know, I'm confident HR can rise to these increased expectations. It will take time, and there's some great examples out there, and hopefully we highlight some of them on the podcast every week.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what a great place to finish, David. I agree. I think a very exciting future ahead for HR, and hopefully we'll see a lot of your predictions play out in 2022. So that just leaving to say Happy New Year. It's been a delight putting you in the on the spot today. Looking forward to the year ahead.
Well, and thanks for going easy on me, Ian. And just for anyone listening, we'll put links to some of the research. So if people want to delve into that themselves, they can in the publicity. But yeah, Happy New Year to all the listeners as well. And Happy New Year to you, Ian.
All right. Thanks, David.
In this series, we will be speaking to a range of senior leaders who are pushing a data-driven and digital HR agenda. Make sure that you subscribe via your podcast app of choice and also via our YouTube channel for free and regular interviews with the digital HR leaders of the future.